Hello dear students, welcome to the lecture 7 of Advanced Programming, as known as also Introduction to Programming 2. So as you already seen, your semester project is ready. Hopefully I will upload it today along with your video. I have prepared a very detailed document, so after you have read this document, you should have all the details, all the idea about the project. If you still have questions, always come to our Discord channel and ask whatever comes to your mind. But please read this document at least two times or three times better. It is about 4 pages, and we also have some images to give you an idea. Okay, this is for ideas, not you don't have to make like this. Actually, you should make it even better. Okay, this is just a draft of ideas to give you what kind of design you may have. I want you to make this project as you are doing it for your employer. Okay, so do not make it for just to pass the course. Make it for like you are doing it for your employer. Okay, anyway, let's continue to our course. So I will copy and paste our previous lecture, since we will continue from that one. Okay, lecture 6 to lecture 7. Okay, and let's open our project. Let's also open SQL Server Management Studio because we are using it a lot. By the way, in the project, I don't force you to use C Sharp and MS SQL. You can also use other languages as long as you can do the project. Okay, since this course is not about C Sharp, it is about advanced programming. Therefore, I don't force you to do it in C Sharp. Okay. All right. And so let's start with renaming lecture. It won't rename everything. It will only rename a few things, but still better than nothing. It won't rename the namespace, for example. Okay, but since we have composed a new folder, then you will be able to easily access each lecture from our GitHub repository. Okay, let's run the application and quickly remember where we have left. If you are remembering, we were using Entity Framework for our database operations. We were learning that. Okay, the application is starting. Also, we had designed a database which was PMS, Patient Management System. Okay, the application is still starting. We have our tables here. Okay, it is taking quite a bit of time in my computer. Okay, now it is ready. So we had designed a register, and I will start with improving our salted hashing. Okay, so let's see, where is our salted hashing function? I think it was inside. Okay, where was it? Let's look from our code. Here, inside global methods, and we have return user password. Okay, so you see, we are using a static string here. However, The more proper usage would be assigning a random string to each user. Okay, so I'm going to make a small modification to this. Actually, this is also fine because we are making it unique with the first name, but yeah, I will do something else. Let's say SR random string, or we can also define a GUID, and you want that what is GUID. I'll show you. Okay, so what is GUID if you wonder? Okay, so GUID stands for Global Unique Identifier. It is a 128-bit integer, 16 bytes. There are usually so many combinations. And how can we generate it? It is simple as this one. Okay. So let's add it to our code. Where we call this, we call it here. So I will also add a key to my users. I mean, add a column to my users table. It will be used for salting. Okay, let's call it as salt of PV password. And since GUID is 16 bytes, it should be always exactly as how many characters? Let's see it. Okay, so let's make a test. Okay. So in here we are going to object. Okay, you see it is already exist. So string. Okay, let's put a breakpoint here. We will get an error probably. Yeah, here. Okay, let's see the error. Okay, here. So it will be combination of a random string. We don't need this anymore. Okay. So for each user, we will be using a unique identifier to salt their password. With this A, we will ensure that none of the user passwords can be decrypted with any hash table, rainbow table. Okay, so the GUID is generated like this. Okay, let's look from here. Okay, 36 characters. And they are in constant length. Okay, so I think this is the constant length, but it says 37. Okay, I see. So we can use string method. Okay, we will use the string method. The string method, it is sufficient. So I will make this as character 36. Okay, since it will be only English letters, we won't allow null. Therefore, I have to delete the entire table to make that change, because if you don't delete the records, then it will throw an error that it cannot insert null value to non-nullable columns. Therefore, we delete them. If I had allowed nulls, then that save would be possible, but since we won't allow, it won't be. Okay, now that we have modified our table, we have to modify our generated code here. You can do it automatically, or we can also add it here manually as well. But I think I will use automatic code generation. Okay. Let's see how will it generate. Or let's manually generate it. I think it should be easy. So we have user password 64 character. And let's see. It has generated it like this, string length 16. Why? It is actually, oh, this is user pv is, yeah, it is here. As you can see, string length this way it is done. I wonder if they are is defined anywhere else. I see. We also have to modify here. Yeah, okay. So let's just auto-generate instead of manually doing it. Okay, so how we were doing it? We will remember also reverse engineer. Okay, and just the rest is by default. We don't touch them. Okay, tables. We are getting all tables. And I'm just clicking OK. It should update all of these classes automatically. And let's see if we have one. Here, as you can see, salt of PV is added. I think it is also added here. Let's see. Yes, it is also added here. Okay, and it has required and string length 36 characters. Okay, now we can continue our application programming since we have updated our code to the latest and synchronized it with our database. Okay, so basically this time we will be using random string and user password. However, we have to save this salt in database as well. It will be simply like this. Okay, salt of PV will be equal to VR salt. Okay, you can also assign it like this as well, so we won't be having extra code. Okay. All right. So now when we are doing a login, we will use this approach. So let's start coding our login section. In your library project, I am expecting you to have salted password as well. Okay, so this was registered. In the login, we will use email and password. So let's make this tab as login. Okay. And here we are going to have a text box for login. Put a label. By the way, you should also make a more appealing user interface design. Currently, I won't be wasting time, spending time for better user interface. But I am expecting better for you. Let's say email. You can easily find better interfaces, how to make a better design on the internet. You can use grid. I think I have taught you that in the previous semester, if I remember correctly. Okay, txt email. And let's remove the text. Oh, we have already txt email. Therefore, I will name it as login email. Okay. Txt login email. And let's make it a little bit bigger. Okay, it is not important anyway. And then we are going to have a password. Okay. Password. For password, we are going to add a password box because it increases the security of the application. And let's name it as name txt login password and then add login button. Okay. Okay. Login. And you can also add remember password feature to your application. I think I can also show you that. Yes, we can use SMTP of Gmail or something else. Okay, BTN login and let's add a click event. Okay. So in the click event, what we are going to do is I will also add another class here. So let's add a folder to our classes. Okay, so the first folder will be let's name it as custom classes. And you can group them as you want. So I will add this register to here. And okay. And add another class here as login operations. Okay, so this will be also a public static. And we are going to simply use the same approach. Okay. By the way, I am also using a context, but before doing context, we can do some checks, such as if user has entered password, email or not. The controls are up to you. Since I am using entity framework, it will be automatically secure from SQL injection. And what I am going to do is I will use find. Okay. And here find entity type will be TBL users. And it says key values to find. And how do we or let's make it like this TBL users find. Okay, now params object key values, the values of primary key for the entity to be found. Okay, so maybe we use search or select. Maybe select is better. Yeah. And here select dot. Okay. Email will be equal to or where Select. Okay. Or where? Yeah, I think where is better. I don't know if it would make difference. Let's check it first. Okay. Okay, so the find starts by searching local cache. Where always sends query to DB. I see. So this is the difference. You see, you should look for differences when you are doing something new. Also, when we do find, we just provide the primary key ID, which wouldn't work for us. Okay, so this is what we need. So let's read this answer. I like it.
Find has a fundamental difference to where, single, first, etc., in that it will first search for the object in memory and only hit the database if the object has not already been loaded. Thus, try to use find where possible, as it offers possible speed benefits of loading from memory. Find only works with the primary key and doesn't support lambdas, so it is not very flexible. Where is typically used to get a listing of objects. To retrieve a single object, I normally use either single, singular default, first, firster default. Single and single or default differ from first and first or default, as they ensure that a maximum of one object can satisfy the criteria, which helps ensure the integrity of the data in the database. The single clauses do this by selecting top two in the SQL query and then throwing an exception if two entities are returned. Note that you should not chain these to the end of the where clause. So instead of where s equals s dot id equals equals 1 dot first or default, use dot first or default s equals s dot id equals equals 1.
Okay, so what we need is we will use first or default, and let's also do some another search. I see. So this is the approach they have used. It was also in my mind, but I am looking for if there is any special method or approach. Returning the first element and if it is null or not is the way to do it normally, but maybe there is some other special thing. Okay, anyway, so let's use TBL uses first or default. By the way, we use first of or default to get if it is not existing, it will return default value, which is null probably. Okay, and now we are going to write our link expression PR dot user email equal to txt login. The main dot txt txt login email and pr dot user pv equal to okay and I see so this is not the way I would like this. How can we apply the chain? Why this end is not working? Maybe we need double Equal. Oh, I see. We have to use text here. You see, sometimes I might also get confused. And bool and string. Let's look for this. It says, okay, bool predicate we need and password equal to global methods return user password and something like this. Okay, where we have, maybe we need to group them like this. Okay. Why it is not working? Okay, so maybe like this and that. Okay, does this work? And okay, so we have figured out it requires single and here we will be using global methods dot return user password. Okay, so for this to work, first we have to check whether user email exists or not. Okay, so however, how we are going to do it, we are going to do it like this. Okay, we don't need this. And we will call it as we are user email. And then we will continue. Okay, so let's put a breakpoint here and see what happens. Oh, we didn't call this method. Okay, so here it will be login operations. Okay, why we can see it? I know the reason, because I have to add this dictionary to using, like this, using custom lecture 6 custom classes. If you don't add a directory, then you may not access it. Okay, now it is accessible. And oh, let's change the name to login try. Okay, and we will just pass our main window reference. Okay, so let's go to here and run the application and see if we can find email and what object it returns. You see, I don't know how the first or default behaving right now. So I am putting a breakpoint here to debug the application and see what kind of object is returned, and then I will continue my coding from there. And okay, it says no database provider have been configured. Oh, I see. And since we have updated our code, we have to reset the database provider And each time you do that, you have to do it. Unfortunately, it doesn't put that the database provider. Maybe from our options, we can edit. Let's see. You see, there were too many options and we didn't look for options. So let's look for it. And it was called as EFI Core Power Tools. It is still fetching the database, and meanwhile, okay, we are here. Good. Okay, tables, and maybe here. There may be an option. Okay, you see, include connection string in generated code. I think this is what we need to check, and let's see what happens. Generating code, you see on the left bottom of the screen. Visual Studio is displaying generating code. Okay, generated. And let's see. Yes. Okay, so it has also added a warning. And it says to protect potentially sensitive in your information in your connection string, you should move it out of source code. You can avoid scaffolding the connection string by using the name syntax, read from and such. So I will just comment this out. And now our code is added. Okay. Okay, let's first register for contest@gmail.com 1 and 1. It doesn't matter since we will be hashing our password. By the way, let's look our hash and how it works. I am putting a breakpoint here as well. And user type will be patience, register. Okay, so our password is 1, random string is for count. Oh, okay, so we didn't fix it. Let's first fix it in here. You see how it is important to debug and check, test your application. So I will be passing password instead of the salt of password instead of the user first name. Okay, so the first name will be Furkan Gözükara, email test@gmail.com 1 and 1. Even as insecure as this password becomes extremely secure when you salt your passwords, register. And now our salt is here, as you can see. And then when we return, the hashed password becomes like this. So this password will not be existing in any of the rainbow tables. Therefore, there is no possible way for hackers to know this password without brute forcing. Of course, they can brute force once they fully obtain our database. However, it will take extreme amount of times. And let's see. Yes. So this is the salted password and this is our salt. Okay. So let's go to our login now. And at the login, we will check email and password, but we don't check the password yet. So first we are going to find if this email exists or not. And it has returned an object. It has returned the object of the user, as you can see, full values. Oh, I see. We don't have to make another check. It is simple actually. Okay. So if we are user email equal to null. Okay. I think what else can it be? It can be. Yeah, it's, I think null should work. We will put a message box or main dot show. No, not show. Message box show. By the way, for using message box, we have to add a reference using system windows and show no such user is found. Okay, and then we will return. Okay. Let's say error. No such reason. And then we will check the password if it is correct or not. How we are going to do that? We are going to do it simply like this. We are user email password. If it is equal to okay, global methods return user password and it will take main.txt login password dot password to string and then it will take the random string which is in our object right now, which is the salt of password, and if they are equal, it will login. Otherwise, it will return error like this. And how we are going to do that? Oh, I have to make it like this. Okay. If it is not equal, an error. The password is not matching. Or let's say the password is incorrect. The entered password is incorrect. By the way, you also have to keep login try in database counts, and then if user frequently tries incorrect password, you have to block them. Okay. Otherwise, they can try login to your system with brute force and find a lot of people passwords. So it is another precaution that you have to take. Let's also take that as well. So to it, we are going to add another table. And let's see, I will take a pause. Okay, so what we are going to do is we are going to check how many times a user has tried to log in the system. By the way, normally this would be check it with the registering IP of the user, okay? Because in an online system, every user has an IP. Therefore, I will just illustrate the system with giving manual IP. So, which columns we are going to have to check number of login tries? We are going to allow a user to try logging in 5 times in 15 minutes. Therefore, let's say, okay, try it IP, and it will be same as here. So var character 16, not null. Then there will be a date of try. And it will be a date time, and combination of these two will be a primary key. Okay, and let's see. Okay, TBL login try. Okay, now we will also include this to our code. Let's reverse engineer our table again. So you see now it is not picked. I am checking it, including string and everything. Okay, it is done. So in here, if user enters an incorrect password, we are going to add a record to the database. So I'm going to define a static IP, a constant IP here, or let's say it should be user based. So let's add a method here. Return user IP. Normally we would get IP of the connecting user with the framework we are using. For example, in ASP.NET, get user IP, but currently we don't have that. We don't have anything to simulate that. Normally it is something like, okay, this in C sharp. Okay, it is something like this. You see, we add some references, whatever. However, in this case, since we are not server-based application, I will just return something for illustration. Let's say some valid IP. Okay, let's return this. And we can also use call of this method into our register operation as well. Okay, and in the login we will also get that IP and check whether that IP has five try or not. How we are going to check that? We are going to check it something like this. Test result equal to context TBL login try, and we need to select count. Okay, so we are going to do select. Okay, where select dot, or where we can use where as well, where PR dot tried IP equal to global methods dot return user IP. And we need another rule, which is and. Okay, by the way, this is equal equal. Actually, we don't even need, but we should, yes. And PR dot date of try. Okay, now we can add time frame. So we are going to check last 15 minutes. Therefore, I am going to add minutes 15 bigger than date time UTC now. So why I am using UTC now? Because this way I am globalizing my server date. You can also use local time, whatever the time you are using. Actually, that's also Make it more more global in our application. What I mean is in our global methods, I will add another method here. Okay, public static date time return server time. Okay, so this way I will have constant time everywhere. It will just return date time UTC now. Okay, and I will call this here. Global methods return server time. Okay. So with this approach, we are going to find IP records where they are made within the last 15 minutes, and I just need their count actually. And how can we calculate their count? Maybe like this. Yeah. So if this count is bigger than 5, if IP test result bigger than 5 or bigger or equal to 5, okay, we are going to show a message. You have error. You have so many times tried to log in within 15 minutes. Try again later. Okay. And if incorrect password happens, then we have to add a record to our login try. And how we're gonna do that? We are going to do it as add, and now it will be expecting a login try entity. So TBL login try temp try equal to new login try, and temp try dot tried IP will be equal to global methods and return user IP. Temp try tried IP will be equal try day date of try will be equal to global methods dot return server time, and we will just edit like this, and then we will save. I think save changes. Okay, and then we will return. All right, and yeah, let's see how our application works. By the way, you can also look for the queries that are being executed from, as you know, our provider. Let's refresh our tables and see our login try. Okay, I also have a debug to see if our application working fine or not. So let's try login AA. By the way, that doesn't exist. Okay, IP result is 0. And now it will check user email. Since it doesn't exist, it will just return. By the way, you can also look for invalid emails, try, if you want to, because with that way they may scan existing user emails. So it would make sense to log that as well. So let's make this into a method here. Okay, increase login try, and we also need to add this to here as well. Okay, and yeah, private static void. Okay, and we will just call this here and here. All right, let's retry We can also look for the queries that are being executed. Let's also look for them as well. Let's close this page. Okay. And the profiler, I will just open tuning. Okay. And let's see which kind of queries are being executed. AA, login. Okay. So let's see the queries. So it opens connection. It selects count star means selecting everything. Where it is checking it with like this. And here, this is the query it is executing. I would execute this differently, but probably it is the way of executing in entity framework. And then it is checking email like here. And then it is inserting into TBL login try, as you can see here. Okay. These are automatic queries done by Microsoft SQL Server. You see insert into values. Okay. And these are the values. Let's also execute. Okay, as you can see, it is here. Okay, no search error found. No, no. Each time it will add another record. No, and now that we have five. Okay, now we have five. It should give me an error. Okay, error. You have so many times tried login within 15 minutes. Try again. Now we have error, as you can see, another record added. And okay, each time we are getting another record because we are also increasing login try here when it is tried. And we are forcing a hacker or the person with malicious intentions. However, this is also bad because this table may get fill it up pretty quickly, a lot of extra unnecessary space. So you should not increase login try here. Okay, it is a bad practice, and just here, because here they are doing nothing simply. They cannot do anything. Okay, now let's change our IP. And where it is? Yeah, let's add another string here. And okay, now we are going to check our password. You see, when we are checking password, we will check it with the salted method. GUID. And if everything is fine, we will log in the user. How we are going to do that? So in our global methods, or let's add global variables or login variables, whatever we want. Let's add a login variables class. Okay. Actually, we can add it into login operations. So here, let's add some variables, public static bool is user logged, fully by default false. And then we can keep the user logged in user details in the memory. However, that may be dangerous. So I'm going to do something else. Public static. Okay, so since we will allow only single user to be logged in at the same time in our application, let's make it as TBL users. Yeah, let's say logged user. Okay, It will be by default. A moment. By default, null. Okay. And if login is successful, here we are going to assign it to your user email. Okay. Once when I assign it to this one, after even this using clause, it won't get destroyed because since this is being referenced to this one, it will be kept by the garbage collector. And however, I also need to delete some values so that it won't remain in the RAM memory. And so how can we delete them? Let's say equal null. So what other sensitive information we may have? Actually, this is also not sensitive. Yeah, I think I can. Maybe salt. Oh, I don't know. It is up to you. You can nullify the sensitive information. So they won't remain in RAM memory. Okay, now we also have the logout user. And we can update or display some information on our main window as logout user. So I'm going to pull this down a little bit like this. And then I am going to add a label to here. Okay. And I will display here some information. What kind of information I will display? I will show you in a moment. Okay. Okay. And let's add. Let's make it like here. Okay, and name VBL login status. Okay. So this login status will be updated each second. And to do that, what I need to update that label each second, I need a timer. Okay. So let's add a VPF timer to our project. And for timers, what we were using? We were using dispatcher timers. So I will add it to global method and here public static void start timer. Or let's say start info operations. Okay. And it will start the dispatcher. And for to be able to use dispatcher, we need to add using system threading. And oh, I see. This is not a correct here. Here the correcting. Okay, it is using full path, but since we have added the reference, we don't need it anymore. And now we need dispatcher timer tick. For this new event handler, you can also do it something like this. Let me show you. And okay, it didn't automatically started composite actually. Let's copy and paste it as well. So this will be private void. Okay, update label. And or let's say update private static void. Update info label. And here I will add another thing to keep login time. Actually, I can keep it inside login operations as well. Public static date time and DT login time. Okay, not keep it here. I think I will keep. Yeah, I can keep it here. So login time. Login time equal to nothing. I will just set it here. Okay, so is user logged in equal to true? Actually, we don't even need to keep this variable because since we are keeping this one, we can keep it. Okay, we have login time. So let's set login time as well equal to date time or server time. Okay, global methods get server time. Okay, and then I wonder if we can define an extension to date time. So let's try that. Okay, public static date time. Let's make it as this dot date time. GG. And now instead of that, okay, where is our login operations? And now date time return or okay, so extension is struct, therefore it is something different, somewhat different. Okay, public. Oh, okay. So it is written like this. Okay. So let's change this into public static data. Okay. So this is the way of defining date time extension, struct extension. Since date time is a struct and it will just return date time UTC now. Okay, so this is the get method, as you can see. All right, now whenever we have, okay, now I can use as server time. Why it is not working? Daytime helper. Oh, I see. Why I can't use it something like this? It's still not extending the official struct daytime. Interesting. Okay, there is another thread here, extending daytime. How do we do that? Okay, namespace utilities. It is the same actually. Oh, I see. So this was somewhat different. Why it returns integer? And return, okay. Daytime, UTC, now. Okay. And time. Okay, let's try this way. Why I can't see it? Testing. They are all returning integers. I see, using utilities. So maybe we need to. Maybe we need to do it something like this. No. Okay, this is really weird. This is private. This should be public. And now let's retry. I wonder if this is necessary, daytime extensions. I see. So only way looks like we need to have our custom class, and let's write it here. The class daytime helper, and it will be daytime server time. Okay, so this looks like the only way. Return daytime UTC now, like this. Yeah, this is looks like the only way. So instead of daytime, we will use daytime helper server time. All right. And it will be same here. And it will be same here as well. Okay. Okay, and now we are keeping the login date as well. And in our global methods, in our dispatcher, so it will start with every second. Like here, interval. And what it is going to do is it will check first logged in or not, and how it is going to check. It will check it with login operations. However, it is not available here, so let's add it using lecture 6 dot custom classes. Okay, login operations dot logged in user. If it is null, that means that we are how do we call it? Let's say we are not logged in. I also need to be able to access main window. Therefore, I need to use this public main. Okay, actually I will assign this to here. To global variables, global methods. Okay. So let's define it here. And on here we are going to use global dot main equal to this. Yes. All right, and on global methods we also need to call this. Let's call this in here. Okay. And in our global method. Okay, what we are going to do is we are going to do dispatcher begin, or let's say main dot dispatcher dot begin invoke, or label, we can directly say that as well. DBR log status dispatcher begin invoke. Okay, was like, I don't exactly remember the syntax, but we will, yeah, this is working nice. And main.libia.login.status.content will be equal to something. Okay, not logged in. Okay, application runtime. Okay, for application runtime, I also need another date, and yeah, let's keep it here. Okay, private static. Okay, up date time and up run date, or up runs date. Yeah, it's fine. It will be date time helper dot server time. And we will calculate the runtime as, okay, datetime helper dot server time minus, okay, update. We will just display the total seconds here, and zero plus seconds, however the seconds, whatever the seconds it is. All right, and just return. If user is logged in, our message will be different. And that time, let's say logged user is, okay, let's use our format, so it will be from login operations dot logged user dot, okay, so the first name of the user and then the dot logged user dot sec surname or last name, yeah, and session time. This time I will use session time. Session run time, and it will be okay. Session runtime will be equal to we will use login date. It is inside login operations dot login time. And by the way, we have. Yeah, it will be here. So it will be datetime helper dot server time. Okay. And let's run our application to see if our code is working as expected or not. Okay. Okay, you see, not logged in application runtime is getting updated each second. If application freezes, this may also freeze. Okay, so let's register and then try to log in. Okay, the first, let's compose an account. Email will be furkan.test@gmail.com. Password will be one. Let's pick as medical doctors register. Okay, user has been registered. We are still not logged in. Let's try an incorrect password. Furkan dot. Okay. What was our email? Yeah. And I will try a different password. Okay, error. The entered password is incorrect. And we should also see that in login try with our new IP here. Let's enter our correct password. Okay, now we see logged user Furkan Gözükara session runtime 5 seconds. Of course, we should disable login and enable exit buttons. Also, we should disable register as well. It is totally up to you to. Currently, we are displaying everything fine. This is getting updated each second. Okay, and after login, we can display a logged in message and disable that tab. How can we do that? So let's go to our tabs. Okay, so top header login. I also need to give a name as top login. And here, okay, name. Oh, not this one, this one. Name top register. And after the login operation, which is here. Okay, we are going to tab login. Okay, tab login is in main. Tab login enabled or is enabled. False. By the way, you should also make this a method actually. So, but let's just write it for now. Tab register. False. And making this a method is better because when you add a logout button, you can just call that method. So I will just make this a method call. Yes, that is a better thing. So in global methods here, let's write a method public static void and change login status. Here it is just going to set opposite of okay, opposite of the enable. And oh, you see I am getting error because this is not inside the parent class. You see, you cannot write methods outside of classes. Every method is written inside a class in C sharp. So change login status, and here I am going to simply use like this. So this will just change whether it's enabled or not, and I will call this inside login operations global operate methods change login status. Okay, here, and let's show a message, show login is successful or you have successful logged in. That's a better warning. Okay, let's start again. So when I add and logout button, now I can just call that method. Okay. Therefore, I will have better control, better efficiency, and lesser code, lesser duplicate code. Okay, you have successfully logged in. Now these are disabled. If I had a logged tab here, I would just go to there. I should also delete these values from text boxes. Okay. Okay, so let's also add a logout button which will appear after logged in. So here are status. Let's make it this size and add a logout button here. Okay. Let's name it as log out, or simply log out, and out. Okay. And this will simply do a pretty easy thing, but let's add it also here. Okay, public static void, okay, log out, or let's say try log out, try log out, and you see, I can also pass parameter like this, or I can use the reference in the global methods. So what this is going to do is simply it will nullify this logout user equal to null, and it will change login status. Okay, change login status, and a message. Okay, you have successfully logged out. All right, and then there is one more thing that we have to do, which is when we do start operations, we are going to make this button visible. Okay, main dot btn logout visibility equal false, and by the way, this is invisible, system dot visibility hidden. We are going to change visibility. Okay, how we are going to do that, I mean where we are going to do that, we are going to do it in change login status as equal to opposite of visibility. Oh, we can't do it. So what we need to do is we are going to do a switch visibility, and it has automatically generated this code. If it is visible, we will set it as hidden. If it is invisible, hidden, we will set it as visible, and others can remain, they don't matter. Okay, let's run the application and see if it is working or not. Okay. Okay, let's try some incorrect login. It says not found. Let's try a different password. Incorrect. Let's try correct password. Yes. Okay, we have successfully logged in and the logout button has appeared here. This message is also correct. And when I try logout, click logout. Oh, nothing happens because we didn't call our method. What I mean is, here we are supposed to call login operations dot logout. Try logout. Okay, and let's. Okay, one second. Okay, let's change this like here a little bit bigger and this a little bit left. Okay, at the beginning, logout button should be invisible because we didn't log in yet. Yes, it is invisible. And let's log in. Okay. And now it is visible. And when I log out, we have logged out. You see this message also changes and these become available. Okay, watch me. I log in. These becomes unclickable. They are not enabled. This becomes visible. Logout button becomes visible. And this session is restarting. And when I log out, you see it returns back the application runtime, register and login becomes available again, enabled again, and I can log in again. So our login system is fully functional right now. All right, everything is working perfectly fine at the moment. However, you see we are embedding our table names as well into our application code. And these may cause some system vulnerabilities, but I don't know if there the better approach would be using server side APIs to treat do online operations, server-side operations. However, currently we are just learning how it is done. We are also taking every precaution that we can take. And but also, if this was an application that is connecting with a remote server, we can never add our connection string into our application because this string can be easily found from our exe. Do you know how? Let me show you that as well. But before doing that, let's take a note of what we have seen in this lecture. Okay, in lecture 7. Okay, what we have seen so far. So, let's look. Okay, we have used it. Or let's start from beginning. How to properly salt user password with GUID. So how we, this is read global unique identifier. Yeah, this is the better explanation. GUID. Let's say first What is GUID and how to properly set user password with GUID and hash it. Okay. Okay, how to develop a proper login system. How to keep logged in user information in the RAM memory. Okay, and how to enable, disable tabs and objects. Well, let's say tabs. Okay, how to change visibility of elements such as button, C#.NET. Okay. And what else we have displayed? Okay, how to do query. How to do login or login queries in, or let's say with entity framework, such as checking if user exists and if password is correct. How to implement security login try system. Okay, or how to properly implement early design table and design. Okay, how to update entity frame for classes with including, okay, database connection string in .NET core application or project. Okay, and okay, in our clone methods. Okay. How to extend, maybe, yeah. Sucks. Yeah. And okay. Okay, so by the way, do you know why I have user dispatcher begin invoke? Because this is a subthread. Okay, therefore it cannot access elements of main thread directly. Therefore I have to use dispatcher begin invoke. And okay, how to use dispatcher timer in .NET. Okay, core VPF application as a timer. How to access main window elements or UI elements from sub threads with, okay, dispatcher begin invoke. And what else there is? Let's remove this PMS bug backup. So I will just re-edit. Okay, let's close it as well. Let's take a backup. Okay, and let's delete the old backup. JSC. Okay, DB. I will delete this. And rebackup. Okay, and let's add it to our project. All files. Okay. And yeah, I was going to read this to you from yeah, let's read it from here.
What is a GUID? A GUID is an acronym that stands for Globally Unique Identifier. They are also referred to as UUIDs or Universally Unique Identifiers. There is no real difference between the two. Technically, they are 128-bit unique reference numbers used in computing, which are highly unlikely to repeat when generated, despite there being no central GUID authority to ensure uniqueness. What does a GUID look like? A GUID follows a specific structure defined in RFC 4122 and come in a few different versions and variants. All variants follow the same structure XXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXXX How unique is unique? A GUID is a unique number that can be used as an identifier for anything in the universe, but unlike ISBN, there is no central authority. The uniqueness of a GUID relies on the algorithm that was used to generate it. We'll look at the types of GUIDs later, but assuming a randomly generated GUID, you have about the same chance of getting hit by a meteorite in a year as getting a collision in 10 to 30 trillion GUIDs.
Okay, so it is a pretty random. Okay, and are there anything else that we should note? Okay, I think this is pretty enough for today. I am going to also add another rule to your project. And I think I have noted it here. Also, let's say, or password brute force. Okay. Okay. And let me change this as well. Için okay, let me upload this into our GitHub repository as well. By the way, if you are, even if you are not taking my courses, you can still join our Discord channel and ask me questions. It is totally fine. And there were recently a person joined our Discord channel and asked me questions, even though he was or her was not one of our students. And it made me happy. So it is 100% fine. Okay, let's also upload our today's source code. And yeah, if you have any questions, please ask me, me or your fellow students will help you. I also started adding Google Cloud generated subtitle system subtitles to our videos, and you can also use our videos use our subtitles now. Okay, lecture 7 and semester project upload. Okay. I think I might also make an SMS announcement tomorrow. Okay, and yes, I have prepared both Turkish and English version of the project since you are still a first year student, but of course in the following years I will only make project details in English, so you better get your English improved. Okay, if you have any questions related to the project or the courses or the lecture, please contact me from our Discord channel. And end of lecture. Hopefully see you next.